Hi, this is Janine Schultz with the Chicago Tribune. We're here backstage at Lollapalooza with two of the members of Frightened Rabbit. We have Grant Hutchinson and Scott Hutchinson with us. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hello. How's it going?
It's great. And you guys are from Scotland. So this weather is actually probably, you're used to it?
It's a little more humid than we're used to. We're usually used to, and it should be raining right now.
Yeah.
And we should have Wellingtons
Don't,
on.
Wait. Do not make it rain. Okay. We need everything we can to not make it rain.
That wouldn't be our fault, would it?
So the first time I ever saw you guys was at Lollapalooza years ago, and it was, I just kind of happened upon you, didn't even know who you were, and it was this great, energetic, wonderful set, and it took me about 15 or 20 minutes to realize this was the saddest thing like I've ever heard. I was like, this is so sad, what's happening? And you guys have kind of made a career out of having like kind of uplifting music and very sad lyrics, and I guess, is that more for us or is that more for you to get through it?
Well, initially it's for me, and then if it happens to help someone else, then I'm happy with that. But I've always really enjoyed that contrast of, and the fact that it took you 15 or 20 minutes to figure out that it was sad, because it sounds joyful. And like I really like that you kind of open the door with the music and then you're trapped in my dark world.
Crying, yet also dancing at the same time.
Good combination, yeah, it's a wonderful, I mean, you'll have no friends at the nightclub, but yeah, you're just in the corner like.
Well, and just kind of playing off that, I mean, I think for a lot of fans going through rough times, they kind of turn to your albums. And so you're kind of, you inadvertently, both of you are with them in those hard times and through breakups and things.
Sure.
And like, I guess, so how is it meeting fans? Because for them, they might feel they have like this intimacy with you. And to you guys, you're like, you're just straight. I know that I sat in the room with you on speaker while you broke up with someone.
I mean, I am aware of it, and I try to be, you know, I don't get freaked out unless it's a really insane story. Like, some guy at a bar once told me that I helped him to first have sex with his girlfriend. I don't know how I managed to do that. I wasn't there, by the way. But and I was like, okay, just get me a drink and I'm going to go. But
sometimes it's a strange relationship that they feel that they have, specifically with Scott, usually. And that they think he personally is going to solve all their problems, like some kind of agony aunt. Whereas if you listen to the music, it's the opposite. Insult meant, but he's not good at that kind of thing, you know?
Otherwise we wouldn't have the songs.
Exactly.
So we would have very happy songs.
Very happy, organized, you know, songs about solutions and how to deal with them, you know.
That would be your record.
That would be my record. It wouldn't sell very well.
Yeah.
Nobody would come and see that.
Logical Rabbit.
Yeah.
And so, the most recent album, The Pain of a Panic Attack.
Yeah.
I remembered it. Came out in April. And I know that the last album was 2013's Pedestrian Verse. And after, they were kind of at a crossroads after that album, kind of wondering, should we continue with the band? Like, what's the point? Do we have anything else to prove?
Yeah.
And I guess, take me through those thoughts. And then, obviously, we have a new album, so you didn't go with the opposite of, like, let's call it quit. So how did that happen?
Well, I don't think anyone really wanted to quit. It was about taking some time out to just refresh our, you know, palette. So I went and worked on an album with Andy and Simon, kind of a solo project in inverted commas. That took a little while, and it was a really refreshing process, like to make an album without any pressure and without too much kind of discussion. It was just kind of a freer process creatively. Grant went and did a whole lot of cycling.
Yeah, I did a charity cycle around the UK. I think it was just everyone. The end of the last campaign was very intense and non-stop, and sort of got to the point where it was less rewarding than it had been before. And I think what needed to happen was, you know, not specifically write an album or go on a cycle, but just have a break from being in Frightened Rabbit, because it's kind of all-consuming, you know, and it becomes you. You know, you sit down and you talk to people and you're like, I have nothing to talk about but being on tour and being in a band. And sometimes that's what people want to hear and want to talk about because it's an interesting topic. But you're like, well, you know, I do have other things, or I want to have other things to talk about. So we all took a break, took a step back, and then realized, okay, well, this is what we want to do, and we are good at it. To stop now would feel like we hadn't achieved what we wanted to achieve. So yeah, I'm glad we did it. I'm glad we pulled through.
I was going to say, you two are brothers, so it was really probably hard to take a break from each other, or did you?
Well, Scott was in another country, in LA, and I, in the US, and I was still in Glasgow, so there was a bit of time there. It wasn't so much taking a break even from each other either. It was the fact that Scott and I could actually have a relationship like as brothers again, rather than colleagues, you know?
Yeah, it's
sort of what it had become, you know?
It wasn't that anyone had fallen out. We were just, we weren't communicating. There was nothing to say anymore. There was, when you start this as a group of friends, and kind of, it's easy to forget that. When you're doing this job and it's mechanical and repetitive and everyone's tired, and it's just like, yeah, I want to appreciate these people again, you know? Because they are my best friends. But then you just start to become, like Grant says, colleagues, which is kind of bad. You know, it's dull.
And going back to the new album, we've talked a lot about the lyrics have been you and kind of your experiences. And on this new album, you opened it up to the rest of the band, and I guess the songwriting process.
Yeah,
and I guess kind of talk about that, and also, was it hard to let go of that, or was it a relief to just be like, hey, guys?
It was great, actually. I mean, the lyrics are still my domain. And nobody really wants, I don't think anyone really wants to be involved in that, but it was great to have a couple of examples on this album. The guys were working in Glasgow and just sent me fully formed pieces of music that I just then had to write for. It was great, it was liberating. And actually it's nice, it's almost like those songs, I can appreciate them a little more because I wasn't as involved in their construction. So it's like writing for another band and enjoying Frightened Rabbit's music from a different angle. So I was happy with that. It was great, and it took pressure off, because otherwise it's just, it can be a little bit, the labels asking for one more song, just something a little more upbeat, guys, and I'm like, yeah, okay.
And then I didn't know how to play the drums until I sat down at a drum kit either. So it was a really...
We should all be so lucky to just...
Well,
there's a lot of things I've sat down at that never panned out.
Yeah, well, I'm still learning, That's the other thing, is that Nick, when we start again...
You were actually the master. He was the master of that when he was young. The number of things that he got and went through. Rollerblades. 1 week.
That was more than a week. You weren't even there.
I was there for your rollerblading phase.
Yeah, but everyone had the rollerblade phase at the age that I was.
Not me.
I did not have a rollerblade phase.
I'm
mostly because just I wasn't good at it, but I'll pretend that it was because, I didn't want to.
Well, me and my friends, we Andy is a brilliant rollerblader.
I'm not bringing Andy into this at all.
So why me?
Just saying,
saying it's a generational thing.
Maybe so.
An age thing.
All right.